I was in the first Cinco Latinas. It was very good for my career as an artist. A way of showing women from Latin countries or from here. And then you have an open door so where people can come and see your work. To let people know who you are, where you're coming from, you know, your art. And it just kind of catapulted. A lot of people got to know me. I think that just the experience of being in the Latino Cultural Center, which is a very well-known venue in Dallas, very good artists, you know, because everybody was different as far as techniques, the things they spoke about. Our curator, Viola Delgado, did a wonderful job as far as choosing the artist and putting the show together. I think overall, for me, it was a great opportunity. Working from what I had before, and I'm moving on to something else, but that comes from that. You know, when you're working in some pieces and in a series, then you start thinking about this idea and that idea, and what if I do this like this, and what if I do that, you know, like that. So you start getting a lot of information just from your own pieces. When I did the first show, it was more about memory, identity, where you come from. So who am I at this point in time with my experiences from before and from now? So you are a mix of so many experiences, but just the fact that you're coming from another country, from another continent. In my case, I left my country, and I still, 30 plus years after, I still have a lot of my culture in me. I came from Colombia as an immigrant. It's been a whole journey. I'm still working with identity and with gender, because gender has been very important for me. When I speak in a woman's voice. From those pieces, the idea is who am I now as a woman? I'm so many things, but you know, but one of them is I'm aging. Now, with the Me Too movement and all these things that are happening as a collective, as women, who are we? Our identity seems to be just like gender. Oh, you're a woman or you're a man. But we're so many things beyond gender. Talking about women in general and working on a piece that I'm gonna have at the Latino Cultural Center. It's gonna be just a wonderful array of different women, a collective, just showcasing who we are. 2016, when I did the first Cinco Mujeres, One Common Thread, I was going through cancer. Before that, I was working with more like bigger pieces, bigger sculptures. And at the time, I had to like be more idle, you know, I couldn't, you know, just be moving around too much. At that time, I started working in small pieces, more intimate. I started also doing a lot of embroidery, crocheting, and that actually helped me to entertain myself, because when you're sick, kind of like you don't want to do too much, but at the same time you just don't want to be there doing nothing. It helped me a lot to keep on working just with the same issues talking about right now. And for example, I started doing a lot of embroidery, and this piece is much bigger than what I was doing at the time. But I started doing a lot of mixed media, playing a lot with the paper and with fabrics, and also with embroidery. There's a lot of techniques that you can use, and I just go back and forth from techniques because I love them all. I love to experiment. I love to experiment with materials. So it was just a nice way for me to work small and to keep on working. The work is different, more is in the way that I can be more active and I move, you know, perfectly, so I can move, and I like that. I like to work with my hands, and then I like to be able to move around, so it's more being active. Right now I'm working with these pieces which I did the mold and now I'm casting, so it's a lot of hands-on technique. The narrative is the same. I'm talking about women, identity, and our essence. One of the pieces I work with is called, in Spanish, is called entrega. And entrega means when you give yourself. And as women, in our nature, there's a lot of giving. I became a mother and I gave everything to my kids, to my family, to our home, to my husband. But at the same time that I was doing these family things, then I was also being an artist and I kept working. So I had like all these fronts that I had to cover. I was also going to UNT to complete my master's. It is like you're giving yourself. It's you keep on giving. And there's a moment in time where I felt empty. I felt it wasn't, I was giving a lot, but I wasn't receiving as much. So on that piece, it's not here, but on that piece, I was showing how you can be emptied, but all the things that you gave start taking life by themselves. Like my kids are grown and I see them like wonderful people, and they're studious, they are working hard and they're on their lives getting things done, and I go like, wow, you know, like I created this, or in my art, I never stopped doing it. Sometimes the pace was slower, or, you know, I was educating myself, or, you know, things happen. So it just didn't, wasn't going at the same pace that I wanted it, but still there. So I see the fruits of my work. The other thing that also was, very good in my career was the show that I did with the Cinco Latinas, because it was a great endeavor to talk about our art. Because this field is very male dominated, like a patriarchy. Women right now, we're on the rise of many things, and one of them is we're rising in the field. For many years we weren't even mentioned in books, and we were not being carried by different venues, galleries. We weren't even paid the same amount that, you know, like a male would have sell their piece, and a women's piece was less more than it should. So in that sense, it was very nice to be in a show that is helping women to get there, to work together, to rise up. As I was saying, it's not the same to be a male artist as a woman artist, and it's not the same to be a Latin Hispanic artist versus a, I could say like a white person. And I don't want to be, you know, discriminating anybody, but at the same time I know that we have to work almost double to get where we want to be. have a great dream of being in museums. My art, it's fine art where I have a lot of things to talk about, and sometimes that is not well received, like in a gallery, or you know, people don't want to put you know, issues and maybe controversial pieces in their houses. So I want to be received in places with my themes, with my voice, and that's how I would feel, you know, like successful, that I'm out there. It's not about being famous. It's not a movement right now, but it's just that we're claiming as women where we belong, you know, our space or place in the world and in the art field. You know, I want to be paid the same amount that a man would get for their art piece. I want to get that as well. I want to be able to pay my bills, you know, with my art. So right now it's not happening, but I want to get there. That would fulfill me, and that would be success for me. Be involved in public art. I think that a way of, for the artist, what we do is we document a lot, you know, our time in the world. You know, like I'm 50 something, so I'm gonna be talking about my experiences since I was a little girl until I guess the time I die. So of course we want to be part of the things that are happening. Public art is a wonderful place to do that. You want to talk about communities and history and challenges that people are having, like the history of the place, you know, where things come from, because the places are changing and cities are becoming bigger, and you know, they're kind of like taking over many places that were before, you know, little towns, and they had an essence to themselves. So once you are in public art, you try to salvage all that. And a lot of artists have the pleasure to be mentored by someone. In my case, I was had a mentor, and I still have it, Viola Delgado, which has been, you know, like a godmother to me. I want to do the same with other people. This piece that I'm making right now is gonna talk about women of all races. At the beginning, when I was making the mold, I was going like, how can I represent every woman with one mold? You know, and I kept on asking myself, and I kept on making them and doing the mold and everything. And it's like, how am I gonna do this? How am I gonna do that? So then it came, you know, the idea to me that it wasn't that I didn't have to represent our differences, that I can represent what brings us together, our essence as women. I want to represent all the races and all the women, because you know, there's women everywhere in every part of the world. So it's gonna be represented on skin colors. So all these molds are gonna, dress forms are gonna have, we're gonna come from the lightest light skin to the darkest. Then, of course, when you're making a mold, there's always something about it that it comes different. Even if they come from the same mold, they, you know, one, for example, in this one, there was something in here that it didn't feel totally. And these are things that for me are perfect, because this one is gonna have a mark or a scar that we all have. In my path, in my life, I have so many scars from being a warrior of life. There is a lot of time that is represented in us as women and men. We age, we have kids, or we don't have kids, or we have different illness. And everybody, you know, when they're like in their 50s, 60s, 70s, they have gone through life and they have gone through many things. The other thing is, I'm a twin, and being a twin is just like the same as these two moles. I mean, you see them perfectly equal, but they're different because in every single crave or how they're made and how they came out, there's differences. So with my sister is the same. We look the same, and people sometimes confuse that, you know, oh, because they look the same, they are the same. But every twin will tell you that they're like two different worlds like anybody else. She's also an artist, and we came to art in different, very different ways. She is an abstract painter, and I did painting for a while, but I like now more to work with my hands, so I'm doing a lot of soft sculpture. The funny thing is also that we come to the same themes over and over again without even talking about it. But again, not because we talk about the same, it's like we're the same person. We talk about the same because we came from the same place, the same experiences. I talk about a lot about migration and issues of migration, like belonging and identity, because, you know, one time I was here and then next day I'm over here and I had to leave everything behind, everything I know, everything that I like, that it was known to me. So I talk about that. My sister talks about the same. Identity, belonging, you know, childhood. But her point of view is different. She didn't move like I did. So she's talking about belonging as like an empty space because her twin left. So she's talking about her identity as, you know, I had this sister and now she's gone and we have to live apart. So for her, it's kind of like the same issues, but we talk about our experiences in different places. I think that my artwork is changing in a way where I'm more mature. Things I saw before, now I see them with different eyes, of course, because I lived more. I can talk about things with more freedom. I talk about things with less anger, more serene, because before I was feeling too much for the issues I was dealing with. And now those issues are not changing that much, but what I'm being able to talk about them in a way that people can listen to them and it's not threatening. My pieces are not threatening. You see them, they're very soft and feminine. They don't shock. What I talk about is always something that I'm confronting society with, the things we do, how we treat women and how women see women and how men see women. Even if, you know, you're talking about say domestic violence, what's happening with that person? Is she gonna abandon him? Is she gonna stay? Is she gonna take the abuse? Is she not? What is she gonna do in that case? And every case is different. So I'm talking about not the anger, but the situation. Everybody's gonna have issues in life, but how do we learn about what we're going through? So I think that that's what I'm doing now. You know, I'm talking about kind of like the same issues, but I evolve, you know, from the place I was talking about. You know, one was anger, and this one is more mature, and I'm talking about situations without the anger. Oh, I saw this piece by Magdalena Bakanowicz a long time ago. I don't remember if I saw it from a magazine or a book. She's from Poland, and she has beautiful installations and sculptures. And I saw these bags that she made in burlap, and maybe then after she casted them. And it was like a lot of bags. And actually what she was showing there was a lot of Jewish people that were killed, and she was representing them with the bags. And I saw that piece and I felt in love, and the piece was done, you know, with burlap, which for me are like materials that just call my attention so much. And I went like, that's what I wanna be. I wanna be an artist that can make something like that. And then I started making my art. I come from textile design, and I work a lot with textiles and materials. And then when I start painting, I'm a self-taught artist, so I started painting, and then my painting started to be more three-dimensional than two-dimensional, and I started, like, when I was creating my frames, I always made something different that wasn't like a regular frame. And then I started moving from that, and I decided that I wanted to do a master's in fiber. And fibers is not textile, which a lot of people kind of make that connection, but fiber is about any type of material, because everything is fiber. Like, I'm making molds, and you know, I'm making them from resin, but resin is a fiber of some sort. One day somebody showed me, you know, like, your art is very similar to Louis Bourgeois's art. And I went to look at her work and all that, and it was like she was, you know, she's a goddess to me, especially because her story is very similar to mine. I come from a family from the garment industry. My parents had a clothing manufacturing, and I grew up in that. As a matter of fact, I studied fashion design, and I was a fashion designer for a long time. And right now, my art has moved to mixing those two things together. Like, my fashion knowledge with my fibers and textile knowledge. So I'm making art that, as you can see, resembles a lot of pieces and things that come from that field. You know, like dresses and patterns and dress forms. My father was not a very faithful husband, so he had, you know, like affairs, and my mother suffered a lot from that. And then when you read Louis Bourgeois's biography, she came from this dysfunctional family where they had a business of making tapestry. She had a governess that became her father's lover, and her mother suffered a lot. She's spiders in her work, and they are representing her mother. I see the similarities. She talks a lot about also women and identity, and of course, her situation was very different from mine. I think that she was a trailblazer in how she spoke about women. And you know, she has the women house. We, at that time where she grew up and where she married, you know, a woman had to stay at home and be the housewife. So she created the housewoman piece, and so many pieces. So there is a lot of women that have really influenced my work. Eva Hess was one of them. She worked so much with different materials, and she was pushing the limits on everything that she can produce as far as different or same materials, but work in different ways. In my world where I grew up, Bogota, Colombia, I didn't see as much artists because I didn't know many artists, and my family, my parents weren't, you know, schooled like I was. They didn't have a lot of knowledge. They just completed elementary school, my father and my mother, high school. What I had from them is that they were very creative people. My father was kind of like an inventor, and he was always creating stuff, and my mother was always working with her hands and picking up techniques about doing this and about doing that. And I was always thinking about my mother, like, how does she do this? You know, like, she can work in any technique. You know, she goes, takes a class, and now she starts working in something. So creativity in my house was normal. All we are four kids, and we were all creative. My mother bought this book about crafts, and my sister and I, we used to go from page to page creating every single craft that the book had, because we weren't into television or any of that, and we had a lot of time in our hands when we were, you know, out of school, and we just kind of like did everything. I was taught to create. I was taught that creativity was something normal. They taught me that everything is possible. So I have that in me. So I drew and paint, you know. At school, I was always, you know, the best at, you know, in the class. That gave me a lot of confidence in what I was doing. That's how I started as a creative person. It wasn't any museum or any of that. I started knowing about different artists when I went to college. Another piece that I was working on, that, for example, this one I did when I was in my cancer stage. It was a small piece, more personal, and it's called Falo Kahlo. Frida Kahlo is one of the artists that I admire a lot, and that I think that her art, at the time, that is raw for a lot of people, for me is a wonderful, how wonderful she talked about her conditions. And she was irreverent. She didn't care about anything that people thought, and I mean, she had this strong personality, so not only her art, but her the way to be that she behaved, and for me it's like amazing. And as another artist that is like kind of like out of the she was ahead of her time, you know, even though people didn't accept her at the time because she was very out there for many people, you know, she didn't care, but she was in front of very advanced for the thinking at the time. This piece has a lot of material. It's a dress pattern. I had used fabric and pattern paper. And the other thing that I used, that it's difficult to see this paper like, is actually gut. Also, I use hair over here. Because as I said, my pieces are very feminine and they're not shocking, but at the same time, when you come close to them, then you start seeing things that maybe are not what you expect from them. So this was my way of being kind of like Frida, with a lot of freedom, just talking about femininity and again identity, and using things that are from my style, my own language, pin, thread, and then fabric. I love fabric of any kind, and I had this wonderful piece that is just a gem for me. this type of work is bold, it's different, but I would like people to support in this show. There's gonna be very different styles of art, of techniques, of, you know, colors, and the art talks about different women, kind of like with the same background, but that doesn't mean that we're the same. I hope that people see our work and relate to them. As I said before, my characteristics and the things I lived are not unique. There's plenty of people that are immigrants. There's plenty of people that are women. There's plenty of people that are different races. So what I talk about is something universal that it can apply for anybody. This show, I think, that opens a lot of subject matter for everybody to come and see something different. Tiempo no tiene cuenta, tiempo no tiene cuenta, tiempo no tiene cuenta, presencia, claro como un cristal. Ayúdame a estar presente, medicina, ayúdame a estar presente aquí, ahora, en todo lo que hago, aquí, ahora, en todo lo que hago. Oh, oh, oh. No ayer, no mañana, estoy aquí, no ayer, no mañana.